data provenance and pool growth.
It's really quite appropriate that I'm after Gully talking about data, because an important part of scientific publishing is documenting how we produce data. Where does our data come from? The conclusions that we put in papers, where does that come from? What was our procedures and practices? And to be honest, what we write in papers is often not very reproducible. It takes a lot of effort. A lot of stuff is hidden in notebooks like these. So one of the things about the paper of the future is that I think we need more provenance and more exposed provenance, because provenance provides this critical foundation of accessing authenticity, enabling trust, and allowing for reproducibility. So if we have some sort of provenance of data, we can do all these three things. And actually, there's been a lot of progress on developing provenance systems. And actually, you'll hear from those today in this workshop. So we can kind of divide what you'll see today up into three parts. So you'll see what I call workflow systems, or systems to capture provenance. So you see VizTrails and Wings and Dexy, all are systems designed to help you capture what you're doing in experiments and expose those. You'll see representations of provenance so that we can easily exchange what we've been doing. And that's over in the bottom left-hand corner, right-hand corner. And then you'll see, how do we connect these captures of the experiments that we're doing, the captures of data provenance, to papers to enable things like computable papers and reproducible papers. So we have these various technologies that are out there today, and these are key parts of the provenance problem. And how do we come together to decide how we integrate that into the paper of the future? So I thought of a couple questions, but I'm hoping that we get a lot more around this subject of data provenance. So how do we connect provenance to our papers, right? That's the question I have. How far do we want to get on the road to full reproducibility, right? We may have techniques like virtual machines that let us completely reproduce what we've done, but they won't let anybody reuse what we've done, right? So there's this this interplay between reproducibility and reusability. How do we integrate computational systems? How do we integrate experiments with our papers? And finally, there's some work on standardizing how we exchange provenance data. And maybe we can discuss if it's time to push forward on being able to exchange the provenance of the data within our papers. So there's lots of interesting questions, and I'm looking for some answers, but also for some more interesting questions around data provenance in this workshop.
It's really a thrill to be here and see so many people, some of whom I know for a long time and some of whom I'm finally meeting. I think Phil is right. This is really a unique opportunity. I'd like to say a couple of words about new models. I don't know how many of you recognize this picture. Raise your hand. It's very good. So that was a real new model. That's Douglas Engelbart in 1968, who was showing his augment system, a system for augmenting human intellect by connecting people through computers. And I think nothing that we're doing today even comes close to what Engelbart did in 68. I still think it's a great goal to strive for, the way in which the network was social and it was constructed from the bottom up. Quite exciting work that I guess sets the tone for my couple of words about new models. I think a lot of times it's very valuable to look at work that has been done and wonder why it hasn't been actually taken up. So I guess as you get older, the word new starts to take on a kind of an ironic tone. I remember joining Elsevier in 1988. I was a bushy-tailed low-temperature physicist, And first we thought everything was fine. We were publishing journals and selling them to libraries, and that was all great. And the libraries were buying them and showing them to the users. And then in 91, Archive came, the preprint server. And in 93, my colleague Nico Popelier said, "You've got to look at this. This is Gopher with pictures." And we were thinking, Gopher with pictures, who cares? And then he said, no, you don't understand. You could put pictures of your dog up. There's this guy who put up a picture of his dog. And suddenly we had this realization, and the first thought was, oh shit, you know. Well, this means that anybody can publish anything. And essentially, as publishers, you know, our days are over. And the second thought that we had was, well, we better come up with something new. Since everybody can clearly post their papers and all they need to figure out is the reviewing process, you know, there's no real reason for publishers even to exist. And so we started getting very worried about and interested in what it was that we could do that was actually new. Here's a picture of the Archive server, and this is, for those of you who remember it, the first Mosaic browser. I want to jump forward 10 years. Together with Joost Keerts at the Royal Dutch Academy of Science, we organized a conference that was called Changing Continuity in Science Communication. And at that point we said, all right, so everything is online now, but how is the article really changing? What is really changing here? You know, the fact that we can put paper online is not that thrilling. What are really things that people are doing that are actually different? And we got 12 editors of very revolutionary journals to talk about what they were doing that was different. It was a very interesting conference. And we thought, all right, so we know where we're heading and it just needs to happen. And so I guess here we are in 2011. We're at the Beyond the PDF. I think from the discussions, it's fair to say that it's not just Beyond the PDF. We're also interested in moving beyond other tools such as Word, the way that databases are done, and maybe other tools like Google. I think the idea is, how do we really make the next step in changing the way that we publish science, right? I wanted to talk about a couple of items that sort of way back then we thought it would be very important and very interesting to really change. So I think the top one is really the article format. So the article in itself is a linear narrative. And I think around, you know, the time of Mosaic and all of that, we thought, well, we have to have a smaller publishable unit. This whole article, this whole story, why do we keep writing these stories and why do people keep needing to read these stories? Can't we have a smaller publishable unit, just a thought that you put out there and that you increment? And surely you don't need to repeat your introduction for every single paper that you write. Another idea was the business models. We were quite convinced that everything would be free, since on Archive it was already solved. So technically there was no impediment. It was just a matter of actually figuring out the review process and everything would be fine. The research data was another point. So how are we going to store and make accessible to everybody the research data? And it was clear that some fields pretty much had this figured out. Astronomy in particular was doing a great job of figuring out what is the research data, how do we access it, let's all agree on standards, and let's all deposit our data in the same place. So it was almost solved in astronomy, so we figured it would be almost solved everywhere. Databases, there was a lot of work that was still being done by curators. It was clear that they needed some help, so we needed some tools to help the curators. Authoring tools, we needed something besides Word and WordPerfect. And there were those who had LaTeX, and they were perfectly happy, so they didn't need anything else. But those of us using Word and WordPerfect really needed something. Annotation tools, it seemed obvious that, and again, harking back to the era of Engelbart and before, and the hypertext community, it was clear that now that we had hyperlinks, even though they were kind of boring compared to the hyperlinks that people had envisioned, which were sort of both ways and one-to-many linking and all that, hyperlink was a start at least. But we needed more interesting annotation tools and ways to interact and to let the information that was out there interact with our personal information store and share all that. Reviewing tools, it was clear that the days of closed peer review were over, right? Because, I mean, there was no need for it anymore, really. So we could just put an article up there and everybody can comment on it. Search, there was a great thought that there would be personal scientific search environments. So I live in my own universe of data, my own universe of information. And surely it would be possible to create a tool that would take that into account with everything I searched. It knows what meaning I have behind a certain concept. And I could create my searches and it would remember what I had looked for before. It remembered what data I was storing personally and I was able to share that. Interactive math, again, seemed to be quite solved because LaTeX had solved it and there were standards appearing. And chemistry, Peter Murray Rust was already working on most of the key standards, and that was clearly almost solved. So, all right, so we fast forward. Oops, went up. Okay, I guess I can't do what you're trying to. What I want to do is show you the middle column and then the end column. So please blank out the end column, please. All right. So article formats 10 years later was 2001. The semantic web hit. Yes, we were now calling these semantic papers, and we still had the idea that surely a paper could be smaller than this long linear narrative, and the semantic web would offer fantastic tools for us to go and build this. Business models, well, there was the author paid model. It was the days of PubMed Central, and Vitek Trutch and David Lippmann were really revolutionizing. So this was clearly the start, and the rest would follow very quickly. Research data now was solved in astronomy. They had the Astronomical Data Center, and all the rest of us needed to do was just follow their lead. Databases, well, the curator still needed help, but there was clearly some work going on in recognizing proteins, so that would be done. Authoring tools, we still needed something besides Word. Annotation tools were probably going to come soon. We had Annotia, it was going to happen. We were going to have things like that. Reviewing tools, there were experiments in 2001 on open peer review. The BMJ did that, a journal called Journal of Interactive Media and Education that Simon Buckingham Shum did very advanced experiments. So again, this would probably happen. Search, Stefan Decker's idea of the semantic desktop, where you have your own environment that where you contain your own content and then you share it with people that you know, and you share it with like-minded folks. Interactive math, MathML was there, just needed to be implemented, and chemistry now was solved by Peter Murray Rust, it just needed to be implemented. So, well, 2011, I guess what's interesting, there is indeed a lot of effort in the smaller publishable units. So I think in terms of modular and semantic formats, things like the ontology of rhetorical blocks developed by the W3C, nano publications, you know, smaller access, and linked open data is really helping in this sense. So I think there we've actually have made a real step. Business models, not much has happened as far as I can see since 2001. Research data is still solved in astronomy, but it's not in other fields. Databases, curators still need help. Authoring tools, we still need more than Word. Annotation tools, we, I think, have deferred collectively to PDF as being the standard, and we're not worrying about it. Reviewing tools, similarly, we use a wiki, but we haven't really worked on that. Search, I think we've collectively just let go, more or less. Interactive math still needs to be implemented. Interactive chemistry still needs to be implemented. So I think what's important, maybe new models, you know, captures the whole workshop, so it's kind of easy for me to talk. I think there are indeed very interesting ideas out there. I do think that we, as a community, have perhaps given up on certain things that we should not give up on. I think it's very important that we reclaim the entire space, for instance, of search, of how I interact with my desktop. You know, I mean, there are big companies and they do have software out there, but it's not tailored for scientists. It's often, you can't find, as Peter Murray Rust was making this point yesterday, you cannot find any data on Google. You cannot put any non-textual information in there. It's all driven by needs that are not the scientists' needs. So I think what is incredibly important as we go through these days is to say, first of all, the key point is, how will all these improvements that we're proposing, how will they actually improve science? How are we impacting science? Marianne Marton, who I believe is speaking, said, you know, with everything that I do, I need to go back to the neuroscientist and say, all right, what major discovery came out of this? You know, 95% of the universe is full of black matter. We don't know what it is. You know, how are we going to help find that black matter? How are we going to solve the key issues in science by improving the format of the paper? I don't think we should give away things just yet. I think in some areas we've become a little complacent, and I think we should claim back spaces like search. Things like, you know, your desktop. I still have three filing systems, one on my desktop, one in my email, and one in my bookmark folder. Why can't I just have one single filing system already, you know, and that knows what I mean by a certain word, because I always mean that, and things like that. So I think a lot of times we need to be a little not be complacent and not say, well, the commercial companies are dealing with this, because they don't have the interest of science at hand. Then I think it's important to say, when we do find such big questions, you know, why were these not implemented? What are the really sociological, political, financial, economical, you know, human drivers that have not made them pick up? Why aren't we all following astronomy's lead? And what are the major hurdles that are preventing us from implementing them? And who can take away these impediments? Let's talk to these people and let's find out why they're not changing and what will motivate them to change. And then when are they going to do this? I mean, to me, really, this workshop offers an opportunity. So first of all, after we get some overview of all the things that are being done, but now to sit down and write, when are we going to make this actually happen? Take all these good ideas and really make them happen. All right, thank you.
So what I'm just going to do is just to remind you that each of us is sort of moderating a session that that will take place as part of the breakout sessions, and you'll choose which breakout sessions to go to discuss these things. And this is just a sort of preamble of what the kinds of discussions would be. So when I actually looked at the questions, I'm going to moderate the writing section. This is essentially what the sort of some of the major questions that came out of reading the papers that are going to be discussed in those 10-minute segments. And in some ways, they've been discussed already in different contexts, in different areas, and that's, of course, there is overlap. But I just want to make a different point. And the point I want to make is one as a domain scientist who is really the customer for what comes out of this, and that the way that some of us are beginning to view publication. And of course, the real issue is this balance with publication on one end and reward on the other. And until we actually change in some way how we think about the reward system, it's likely that getting publication to change dramatically is just not going to happen. And I think that, so we really need to begin working on that. And just to illustrate that point, in some ways, I just take my own laboratory as an example. I mean, last year, I think we submitted, and 22 papers were published, and another 13 are in some form of revision. So is that collective work really getting a message out in the maximized form? In some sense, I would suggest the answer is probably no. On the other hand, the people who are doing the work need some recognized reward. So it's just an example of how these things are tied together. And then I think the notion of what a paper is worth is also something that we need to start emphasizing in different ways. I mean, I think in terms of, as for those who are domain scientists in the room, how we view our scholarship. So, for example, I write things that actually are hardly ever cited, but they're downloaded many, many thousands of times. And that, to me, is a part of scholarship, and it's actually something I'm actually proud to be doing. On the other hand, I'm just raising different examples here of trying to sort of point out how we need to think about changing the system. On the other hand, I have one paper that's about a database that's been cited 10,000 times. Well, no one has ever read that paper, and no one really cares about that paper. They care about the database. But it's that particular reference that gives the reward to us, and also to, it makes the people who are using it feel good about it, or it's important for the scholarship. So, on the other hand, I've published papers that have not been cited very many times at all that I'm very proud of, because I think they represent some change. So I think there are all of these things that, as you go through this exercise, think about, for those of you who are working really on other sides of this, say particularly the technical side, to think about what this means to people like me at the end. Because the only way I'm ever going to adopt any of these things is if, when I'm writing, that what I rewrite and what I actually provide, whether it be data or knowledge or whatever, we have to move towards recognizing a reward for that. So that's all, and hopefully we'll discuss this some more. OK. Cameron?
Okay, so in some senses, I think I've got the poison chalice. I also note that one of the categories that Phil didn't include in his group of people here was troublemakers. It's definitely where a lot of us fit, I suspect. We're all trouble. Okay, that's fair enough. Okay, so we start with the question of what peer review does and why we're fond of it, why we're using it. And I think I kind of try to figure out what were the main things that peer review does, and I think this is a reasonable kind of list of the kind of reasons people regard it as important. First, the decision whether you're going to commit resources to the process of publication and dissemination, technical assessment of validity of the methods and conclusions in a paper, an assessment of the importance or the impact of that work, depending on which journal it ends up with, and also to support discovery, to make the discovery process easier by helping people look in the right places for the research they're interested in. So as scientists, obviously we're going to critique this and make sure that it's still the truth today and to look at the data that supports these assertions. And as we start to do that, we start to run into some problems. So on the web publication, I think, so one thing I'd suggest is we start to try and define some language so we can actually speak to each other. So the process of publication on the web is as near to zero cost as to make no difference. The cost of formal publication, of putting that in a place which is indexed and archived and looked after and curated, that does cost money. But the question of making a decision whether to expend resources to make something public and distribute it is not really one that we need to particularly worry about. And we know that the assessment of whether something ends up in Nature or Nature Structural Biology or Cell or Molecular Cell, really that's not a particularly objective process. We know this. There's a lot of evidence that supports this. Unfortunately, there's also a lot of evidence that supports the fact that it's actually completely useless for technical assessment of the validity of papers in particular. The classic example of this is Richard Smith, when he was editor of the BMJ, deliberately inserting errors into papers that were sent out for review. 95% of those errors, which included serious ones that actually reversed the conclusion of the paper, were never caught. And the other problem is that actually none of this matters because we're all searching through Google Scholar anyway. So actually where things are, why are we bothering with any of this, frankly? And the answer is that, and I should have included obviously the XKCD cartoon here, science works because of peer review, because of the review process that goes through looking at science, looking at papers. So how do we match these two things? We have no evidence that it actually works, and yet we know that in the end of the day we can actually do useful stuff with science, so some of this process must be working somewhere along the line. And I think the key point to realise is that we're talking about two different processes, and we need to talk about the language here, so I'm going to suggest that we talk about PPPR and PPPR. Pre-publication peer review, post-publication peer review, we need to divide those things out. So we have a situation at the moment where we have a formal pre-publication process. It's not transparent in any real sense. You don't know who the reviewers were, you don't know what the disagreements were, you don't know how the paper was changed in most cases. It's a binary process. Paper is either published or not published. I'd suggest that it's basically useless as a process, and it's really very expensive. There are various estimates running around about what we spend globally on peer review, and they run from about $1.5 billion up to about $5 billion US a year. That is money we could be spending on curing malaria or solving other important problems. So this is a problem. We do have a post-publication peer review, and this is actually how we really run the scientific process. We look at whether results hold up under testing. We look at whether people continue to agree with the results of a paper. But this process is informal. It's largely unrecorded. It's quite slow. Sending a letter to the editor, saying that you disagree, writing another paper, pointing out what the flaws in something were is a problem, and it takes a long time. It does seem to, in the long term, actually lead to a scientific process that seems to work. We generate results that do seem to map on reality. But there's a lot of unrealised value, and there's a lot of information in this process that we're not successfully extracting from the system. So what I suggest is we want to move to systems where I'm not necessarily saying, oh, well, I would actually quite like to get rid of pre-publication peer review, but I'm not sure that's really a flyer right at the moment. So I think we're still going to end up with a formal process of peer review that ideally would be more transparent,
that maybe some of this is automated processing. Do the results and the methods actually work? Does the software or the underlying systems work? How much of this can we automate to bring the costs down? How can we really extract and do valuable pre-publication peer review that delivers some value and bring that cost down? And in terms of post-publication peer review, can we move to a mixture of both formal and informal processes, some of which are recorded in a structured form that is faster and more effective, that is still valid and useful, and that we're realizing the value out of this for search purposes, for annotation, for structuring, for reward processes, and we get information that's usable. So again, drawing on the Paul's pressure, I'll just point out some of the things that are going on in this space and some of the things you're going to hear about. So Paul will talk about total impact, and he's got a paper on from claim to fact based on the data that Phil made available. Analogical publishing and supporting active reading, and so deciding what not to read, which is obviously an important part of deciding how you're going to spend your day. And I just also wanted to point out some other obvious projects. So Pete Binfield is here, and I imagine we'll talk about article level metrics in some form at some point. So looking beyond the journal to the value of the article itself. And I also just wanted to mention, again, because Paul is here, altmetrics.org is an effort to try and expand the way that research is measured, and I'm running a workshop in London in May to look at research impact and how we can actually provide some quantitative and, again, structured information out of that to support exactly the kind of things that Phil was just talking about. So the questions I think we need to deal with, what works? How can we actually apply a scientific process to the process of doing science? Because we don't, and maybe we should if we were believe in our own philosophy. What evidence do we have? Because people really are fairly unaware of the evidence about what does and doesn't work. What kind of tools and systems and frameworks might support effective pre-publication and post-publication peer review? What do we need to build? What do we need to support? What kind of people do we need, and what kind of training should we give people? And as Phil has pointed out and Anita has pointed out, all of these things are the same things that many of us have been banging on for the last 5, 10, 20, if Merton was in the audience, 40 years. How do we actually make this happen? How do we actually make people, motivate people, researchers, the public, the funders, the publishers, everyone involved to actually change the process? So this is the cultural issue, which I'm sure is going to come up again and again and again, and if we could solve it, then we might make some progress.
So thanks, Cameron, for that. So I think the idea here is you've got some form of flavour of what's going to transpire in these discussion groups. This is discussion, so we'll really get to that, and I think that's going to be the most important part of the meeting. I just want to take a couple of minutes just to thank the people who've made this thing possible before we get into the individual presentations. And Tim, maybe you want to come up and set up while I'm saying this. So in terms of support for this, the Doris Duke Charitable Foundation have been a significant part of this. Microsoft, and thanks to Lee Dirks for that. NCI, and thanks to Dan for that. Creative Commons, thanks to John Wilbanks and Elsevier. If you're having a drink tonight, you can think of Elsevier. And thanks to Anita and Alan for that. And the people in my shop, my assistant Anne, who God knows how she puts up with me, but is just so helpful with all of this. Nadine's our budget officer and has really helped. And Samantha, Sammy's the person that's out the front who's dealing with the CalIT stuff. And so don't hesitate to contact that office or those people out there if you're having issues. So we'll now get into some individual presentations in the annotation section, and Ed will take care of that and make sure people stay on time.